Morrow and Harper Audio present Lula Dean's Little Library of Banned Books, a novel by Kirsten Miller, performed by January LaVoy. In this novel, Lula Dean creates a lending library outside her home. There is a not-for-profit organization called Little Free Library, which is devoted to fostering neighborhood book exchanges throughout the world. You can find out more about them at littlefreelibrary.org. For all the good people down south. Chapter 1. Food of the Gods. Ronnie Childers was tripping his balls off in Jackson Square when an angel of the Lord appeared before him. She was a glorious vision, dressed in black gym leggings and a bikini kill t-shirt, her golden hair twisted into a messy knot on the top of her head. She looked a lot like a girl he used to get stoned with back in high school. The angel hovered over his park bench, the streetlight casting a halo behind her head. "What the hell are you doing, Ronnie?" she asked.
"Am I that fucked up? Or is it really you?"
The angel snorted. "Both," she told him. Tears of pure joy sprang to Ronnie's eyes.
"Hallelujah,"
he said. The Lord sure did work in mysterious ways.
"You've been out in the cow pasture again, haven't you?"
Ronnie giggled.
"You got me."
He opened his hand and presented a little brown mushroom as an offering. The angel plucked the mushroom out of his palm and slipped it into her bra for safekeeping.
"You realize it's 2 o'clock in the morning."
"Then the night is young."
Ronnie patted a spot on the bench. When the angel didn't plop down beside him, he swept an arm across the square.
"I ain't making a move. I'm just asking you to take a moment to appreciate all this fucking beauty."
Sometimes Ronnie wondered how he'd never noticed it before. He'd spent half his life in Troy's town square, under the branches of its giant oaks and magnolias. As his mama cleaned the floors at the DMV, he'd whiled away the hours turning the fountain's water blood red with writ dye, or vandalizing the Confederate general's statue with beautifully drawn penises. Those days were long gone, but the square was still Ronnie's favorite spot. He'd discovered its true beauty on nights like this, when the world was quiet and peaceful, and no one was arguing about book bans and butt plugs and all the other bullshit that got the people of Troy riled up these days.
"You know, this could be a pretty nice place,"
Ronnie sighed. The angel, staring out across the darkness, seemed to see the same thing.
"Yeah,"
she agreed.
"Hey, if you're free right now, I could use a hand. You think you can walk?"
Ronnie looked down at his ripped jeans and work boots. His right leg kicked out when he willed it to move.
"Looks as if. Where are we heading?"
For the first time, he noticed the giant suitcase she'd been wheeling behind her.
"To cause some trouble,"
the angel told him.
"Fuck yeah."
Ronnie stood up and shook out his lanky limbs.
"That's rule number one in the Ronnie Childers playbook. Never turn your nose up at trouble."
It really didn't get any better than this, Ronnie thought. High as hell and traveling through the night with an angel on a mission.
He'd have to be at work at the Piggly Wiggly in a few short hours, but that was just to pay the bills.
This was the sort of experience that fed the soul.
Ronnie was absolutely certain that the world would be a much better place if more folks stepped out of the boxes they'd come packed in and opened their minds to the mysteries of the universe. It wasn't until the angel stopped in front of a house that reminded Ronnie of a prissy white wedding cake that he started his slow descent from the heavens.
"You know Lula Dean lives here."
He figured the angel ought to know. Most people in their right minds did their best to avoid Lula. The angel turned and lifted a finger to her lips. She wheeled the suitcase over to a little purple cabinet fixed to the top of a post just inside Lula's front yard. Shaped like a house and hand-painted with flowers, it held two short shelves crammed with books. Lula's little library was written in cursive below the front eave. The angel opened the glass door.
"Take everything out," she whispered. "Stack all the books in a pile."
Ronnie pulled a thick tome off the top shelf.
"The Southern Belle's Guide to Etiquette. Where the hell does she find this stuff?"
The angel was too busy opening her suitcase to respond. Packed inside were at least 2 dozen books. Ronnie whistled softly.
"Those what I think they are?"
he asked. The angel looked up with narrowed eyes.
"I thought you were high."
"I ain't so high that I can't recognize contraband,"
Ronnie told her, returning to the job she'd given him.
"No worries, Your Holiness. I won't interfere with the Lord's work."
Once there were 2 stacks of books standing side by side, Ronnie stepped back.
"What now?"
he asked.
"Switch the covers," the angel ordered. "Put Lula's dust jackets on the books I brought. Then put those books in her library. Lula's books will go into the suitcase."
Ronnie paused.
"Just so you know, I'm not 100% convinced of the legality of this operation," he told her.
He'd had more than a few run-ins with the law during his 2 decades on Earth. If he weren't a convicted felon, he might have made a good lawyer.
"That gonna be a problem?" the angel asked.
"No, ma'am."
Ronnie shook his head. When they finished swapping the books, the little library looked exactly as they'd found it.
"Good work," the angel told Ronnie. "Come on, I'll walk your stoned ass home."
How long had it been since they'd spent time together like this? At least 2 years, Ronnie figured. It felt just as right as it always had.
"So is that what counts for fun in Troy now? Eating shrooms and sitting in the square?"
the angel asked as they strolled back through the park.
"Nah, most folks around here prefer oxy or meth."
The angel didn't laugh.
"You're better than all this, you know."
"Yeah, well, still not good enough to come up with the cash for college,"
Ronnie said.
"Plus, I got felony possession on my record now, so I reckon I'm fucked. I know this is gonna sound crazy, but if it weren't for the shrooms, I think I might have fallen down a deep, dark hole and never come out."
"It doesn't sound crazy at all. They've been using mushrooms to treat depression. Psilocybin may be Schedule 1 here in Georgia, but it's considered medicine in other parts of the country."
"Maybe I should move to one of those parts,"
Ronnie said.
"'Cause finding shrooms and using them are the only 2 things I've ever been really good at."
"That's bullshit and we both know it. But maybe you can find a use for those skills. Help people and make bank all at the same time. Sounds like a good combination to me."
They stopped at Ronnie's front porch. He could still remember the first time they'd sat on the swing together. Back in the days when neither of them knew that Lindsay was rich and Ronnie was poor, and they couldn't imagine a day when their paths would no longer run parallel.
"I love you,"
Ronnie told the angel.
"I always have."
"And I love you right back," she said. "But as we both know, I'm pretty damn gay."
"Just my luck,"
Ronnie said with a shrug.
"So how long you in town for?"
"I'm heading out tomorrow," she said.
Ronnie laughed.
"You went to all that trouble tonight, and you ain't gonna stay to watch the shit hit the fan? That fancy-ass school hasn't changed you at all. You're one bad bitch, Lindsay Underwood."
"I came down to help my mom, but she doesn't want me to stay."
Then a devilish grin spread across Lindsay's face.
"Don't worry, though. I have a feeling I'll be back in town before long."
Chapter 2. Lord of the Flies. Beverly Underwood just wanted life to go back to normal. You wouldn't think that would be such a controversial position, but you couldn't predict how people were going to react these days. Seemed like everyone was always itching to fight.
I'm touched that you came down from college, sweetheart, but I can handle this. I really don't think it's worth you missing any more school.
Beverly didn't like to see her daughter scowling. Beauty like Lindsay's was a gift from God, and it felt like a sin to hide it.
Is it true you don't need any help? Lindsay shot back. Or are you worried your gay kid will get in the way?
Beverly slid forward on the couch cushion and grasped Lindsay's hand.
Oh, good gracious, no. How could you say such a thing?
Her daughter may have been 21 years old, but she was still Mama's baby, and Beverly couldn't have been any prouder.
Your father and I have given you our full support since that Barbie incident back in first grade. You being gay has never made one bit of difference to us. Then why are you telling me to get lost?
Beverly gasped.
You think that's what we're saying?
She turned to her husband for support.
Trip, did you hear that?
I'm sorry.
Trip Underwood looked up from his crossword puzzle.
What did you say?
Beverly fixed her frown before she turned back to her daughter.
Lindsay, that is not what we're saying. You will always be welcome in this house. All I'm asking now is that you finish out your semester while I try to put all this unpleasantness behind us.
Lindsay studied her mother and shook her head.
I can't believe it,
she finally announced.
You're terrified of Lula Dean.
Once upon a time, Beverly would have laughed at the suggestion. Now she knew better. Truth was, Lula Dean was scary as hell. Lula never could get enough attention. Beverly had diagnosed the disorder all the way back in high school. Even then, Lula had been desperate for people to see her, and she'd been blessed with all the gifts that caught others' eyes. Trouble was, most people never stuck around for a second look. Until her senior year of high school, Beverly couldn't have put a finger on what it was that scared everyone off. Then she'd found how far Lula was willing to go for the recognition she craved, and just how much she believed she deserved it. After graduation, Beverly had planned to leave town and cede Troy to Lula. Of course, that's not how things turned out. For the past 25 years, the two of them had lived in houses half a mile apart. They both attended the First Baptist Church. They belonged to the Booster Club and baked mountains of cookies for the PTA. An outsider could be forgiven for thinking two women who shared so much in common might lead similar lives. But Beverly, now head of the school board, had long been seen as a pillar of the Troy community. Until recently, Lula Dean had been known as the town crank. As usual, Lula had brought it all on herself. After her husband died and her kids left town, a lot of folks took pity on her. She could have taken the opportunity to mend some fences. Instead, Lula seemed dead set on using her time and energy to punish the world for ignoring her in the first place. Most of her efforts never paid off. Nobody gave a damn if Walmart sold butt plugs, or if the gift shop on Main Street carried cards for gay dads. Then, Lula discovered pornography in the baking section of the local library. Within a month, she was famous throughout the state. It didn't matter that a 13-year-old delinquent confessed to slipping the erotic cake cookbook onto the library's shelves as a prank. Lula had found her calling. Having successfully rebranded herself as a righteous crusader, she got right to work. The children of Troy were in terrible danger, Lula announced on Facebook. Within weeks, she'd recruited a group of like-minded residents. Together, Lula's Concerned Parents Committee assembled a list of books they believed had no place in a God-fearing town. Beverly found an identical list online, but Lula claimed it wasn't plagiarism, just proof they'd picked all the right ones. Beverly could have kicked herself for refusing to take Lula more seriously. But over her 44 years, she'd watched countless panics flare up and fade away. A while back, every store in town kept the laundry detergent under lock and key. Now, no one worried about kids nibbling on April Fresh Tide Pods, and Beverly expected Lula's crusade to share the same fate. Then, on the 1st of May, she received a frantic call from the high school's librarian. The principal had allowed 6 members of the CPC into the library, and they were yanking books off the shelves. By the time Beverly made it over to the high school, the Concerned Parents Committee had already moved on to Troy's middle school. The elementary school and the public library were ransacked before the end of the day. As head of the school board, Beverly convened an emergency session. But her fellow members weren't eager to act. The CPC would be holding a press conference the following afternoon, and they wanted to hear what Lula Dean had to say. Stunned by her unexpected defeat, Beverly logged on to Facebook, where Lula had posted pictures of the books they'd confiscated from the town's 4 libraries. "What should we do with this filth?" Lula asked her followers. Beverly scrolled down through the replies. The most common response appeared to be, "Burn it!"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.